All right, good morning. It's been a very beautiful day. It's a raining Wednesday, and I know a lot of Nigerians are out there just going about their businesses as usual. Welcome to Channel 196 and Star Times. My name is Akpabanjo. Welcome to Crossfire. And today we are taking you through a dimension by popular demand. A lot of people have been saying, how come you don't touch issues about sports and sport administration in Nigeria? And we're bringing you something really very interesting today on Crossfire. I'm not alone here. Ishoma is with me, and we'll be running the show together. Ishoma, good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to Crossfire. Congratulations. Your team won yesterday.
All right. Thank you. We won from behind. notwithstanding, Man United remains my club, and there's nothing you can do about that.
I recall how you laughed at me over the weekend when Chelsea lost.
Well, yeah, I was still have to do that because Chelsea is going to lose.
Well, it doesn't matter.
But
I'm happy that you're joining me.
No, I can't join you. This season, Chelsea is nowhere to be found.
Yes, but at least I can give it to Man City rather than mine.
Okay, don't forget. You just like to beef me. Anyway, we definitely will be talking more about that if we have time on the show. But we have these two gentlemen joining us on Crossfire today, and we'll be discussing about sport administration in Nigeria. What has been the challenges, and how do we have to come out of this quagmire that we probably have found ourselves over the years? Do you think that sporting activities or sport generally in Nigeria is well funded? Do you think government intervention is needed? Do you think government has even done enough to help sports in Nigeria? We definitely will be looking at some of these issues on the show today. The first person I would like you to meet is an ex-international, and he's been around for quite a while. And believe you me, this is someone you really want to listen to. He's got a program, something really very interesting. And I'm very sure all football lovers in Nigeria will love this package. And so we'll be talking about it on the show. Let's meet Sam SODJE. Sam, how you doing?
I'm fine. Thanks for having me.
You know, as a defender, don't put up any defense. And then we have these other gentlemen joining us. Believe you me, you cannot have better guests on this show than the people we have brought along your way to discuss on this matter today. I have the very first vice president of the Nigerian Football Federation. And believe you me, we'll be talking football today, but we'll talk generally about sport. Let's meet Barrister SEYI AKINWUNMI. Barrister, good morning. Good to have you on Crossfire.
Morning.
Anyway, we call it Crossfire, and I'm very sure you know Sam very well, and he's not going to throw punches, and I'm very sure you are not ready to throw one either.
Not at all.
All right, so let's just, you know, get educated and enlightened. Now, let's, gentlemen, I don't want to go into any other thing so that we can have quality time to discuss today. Very soon, our callers will start, you know, buzzing our lines to just make contribution. But let's quickly establish what we want to discuss today. Now, I have come to realize that sport has become like a unifying factor. It does not matter the language that you speak in Nigeria, Igbo, Yoruba, Hausa. Goal is goal. I have never seen an Hausa man when a ball, you know, is caught, and then he shouts any other thing. Go now, go, you know. So it's such a very unifying, element in Nigeria. When we sit back at the stadium, any of the stadium, the stadiums in Nigeria, and it does not matter who is sitting beside you. Yeah. Everybody comes to the stadium to support Nigeria as a team. That unifies us. That makes us one. And I believe very strongly that a sensitive government will do everything to ensure that we have a very good platform so that we can continue to use this as a unifying factor in the country. Now, let me ask you, Barrister SEYI, do you think sport is getting all the necessary attention that it should get in Nigeria?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think it has.
Okay.
What the new government says that it will. The issue is there are many structural amendments that need to be made across board. People think that it's just the federal government or the state government that has to do these things. But the private sector has a whole lot of work to do in it. And until we scheme sports to a level where the private sector is really interested in it because they get value from it, then we won't get all that should be the funding available to sports. Of course, the government needs to give the backbone and the infrastructure to ensure that sports administrators can do their work to an extent where we're interested, or we interest the private sector.
Until you made mention of structural amendments. In what areas?
Of the administration of sports. I mean, I'm talking football because that's where I play.
Yeah, you have your culture.
But you know, for example, you know, you find that to run a national team, people underestimate how much it costs. You know, and then you need to get try and get money out for that. In times previous, the FAs have had to borrow money, waiting for government money to come to. For the national assignment, and that just doesn't make for proper organization. So where we need is for the government to back sports administrators to ensure that they're in a position where they can actually go to the private sector. The NFF has done, I mean, just yesterday, the day before yesterday, we were with a certain bank who has agreed to fund a sizable aspect of football. Particularly youth football. So that's the sort of thing that we need to do to get things going. Government has a big role to play, but it's not only government.
Let's compare. I quickly want a comparison before we go into some other things.
Right.
Sam, you've been here and you've been there. And we may need to do a very quick comparison between your exposure out there and how sport, or sporting activities in Nigeria, because I mean we'll be coming down to narrow down to football, where you actually belong and where he plays too. But most importantly is to first establish the fact that what is the Nigerian sport, you know, suffering at the moment. I mean, in comparison, you know, with what, where you're coming from, how do you see sport in Nigeria and then sport outside Nigeria?
Okay, massive difference, because in Nigeria they depend on the government and. They all surround themselves about what the government is going to give to them, as the boss is saying now. But when you come to the UK, it's different, because they're a different body and they go out there and get their funds.
Is government involved?
Not at all. The government is not involved in sports, but they've taken the time to sacrifice themselves, individuals, to sacrifice themselves to create an infrastructure where people can work without going to the government. So the difference is, you get experts in the UK or, you know, abroad that works in sports specific. They don't have to go to people that don't really know about football or know about sport and ask them for funds, because that doesn't work. But they will not understand why you need the funds. But when you're working with people that are experts, that understands, like he was saying, games of, they know why you're asking for the money. So the difference is, because we rely on the government in Nigeria, that is why our sport seems to be lacking behind. Until we get the experts to go out there and go and look for funds ourselves from the back in Nigeria, from the government, but we need to have the expert doing it.
Now, is it private, you know, participation in the, or individuals who just want to make, who are just doing sport as business, are the ones growing football outside the country? You know, what I mean is, if we totally depend on government here, on this side, you know, of the world, of the divide, I'm saying that out there, probably the government already established some certain infrastructure that is enabling enough to make individuals want to come and do sport as business, which we don't have in Nigeria.
And the main issue that I have realized was, I was born in the UK, but I grew up in Nigeria, so I know both sides of it. The main thing I realized, that the difference between Africa or Nigeria or in the UK, is the individuals that is working in sport in the UK, they're more keen on leaving a legacy. But in Nigeria, it's all about the money or what you've achieved. But you go in, like some players, ex-players, that wants to leave and they'll go, he did it first. He was there when this thing happened. They don't really care about what they gain off the sport. That is the difference in Nigeria. And that's what I'm trying to put out there. Legacy is better than anything you can ever think of.
All right,
Now, you talked about experts, having experts who know the business to come and grow it also. And you talked about money also. And you talked about structural amendments. Now, if you put all of these together, Can it also help generate revenue? Can sports generate revenue for the nation? Because if you look at nations like Brazil and Jamaica, they're sporting nations, but they generate heavy revenue for the nations through sports. So if we have all of this, you know, in place, like you both have rightly said, would it translate to generating revenue for the government and for private investors? Will it?
For sure. I think people underestimate the power of sports. First of all, you know, all the known benefits, you know, the health benefits, the civil society betterment benefits. But financially, sport is the biggest business in the world. You know, and people don't understand how much you can make. I'll give you an example. A few years ago, in fact, Sam was in England then, and we, in Lagos State, decided we're going to have something called the Eco Football Festival. Yeah. And it was alongside an international conference called SoccerX, the biggest business conference in the world. And I tapped, or I tagged rather, three businesses that started at that time. And now they're a real big, big industry. You know, people who make shirts and, you know, equipment for football. And if it wasn't for that, they wouldn't be there. And they're tiny businesses. You know, we paid for the stalls for them. Mm-hmm. And they're now big businesses. So I think that people should just look at that as an example and see how much can come. Now, what you attract from abroad, the forex you attract from abroad from, you know, sports, is immense. Mm-hmm. We just need to tap it and harness it properly. And that really is the problem. And that's what I was talking about. You know, people be willing to leave a legacy. And I think for yourself. If you leave a legacy, the money that you're looking for comes.
But you can't leave a legacy, I mean, if you're not patriotic. I think that's also one of the issues we have here, because when we watch international games, you see that patriotism, you see how these people play. But let's also not forget the fact that their government also, you know, take good care of them also. But patriotism is lacking over here.
No,
so
I think
you have the money and all the structures, but patriotism
I differ a little bit.
Ishama, I think that's my opinion.
Let me make one. Yeah, when you talk about if you're playing for a national team, you can start talking about patriotism. If you're playing for club side, you are just in sport for business. No player, you won't tell me you're just playing for the fun of it when you were playing active football.
Please.
What we require there will be loyalty.
You just only have to be loyal to your club at that point in time.
Every footballer, I'll tell you now, no matter how much you earn, when you cross that white line, it's not about the money. The money doesn't count. I'm playing against a gentleman that I think I'm better than, mm-hmm. that I don't want to lose to. So regardless, he's getting paid $10 billion. I'm paying. It doesn't matter. Once we cross the white line,
yeah, that's loyalty.
No, that is the passion we have for the game.
Okay.
I grew up. I started playing when I was 14. Money wasn't my. I just wanted to play football. It's when you get to the age where you're thinking about family. Just to go back, what he just said. You're sitting close to a gentleman that whatever he says now, believe it, because he was one of the people that we could speak to that took us in from abroad and said and bought into our idea. Not because he's in Daniel, but because that's who he is. You need people like that, and that's not money. We didn't give him money. But he's
maybe passion.
Patriotism.
Maybe
so that's what
passion.
The word patriotism.
So, passion.
Yeah. I mean,
passion.
Yeah,
passion.
No,
passion.
Not
there's
passion.
A slight difference between the two. Passion.
It's hard for footballer, for ex-footballer that's played the game for 20 years, to be having a conversation with a fan.
Okay.
Is it a totally different ball game? Because we will not be on the same page ever. Because I would be talking from a different point of view. But if a sportsman or a footballer is sitting close to me, he understands my language, he knows what I'm talking about. All we need in Nigerian football is a man like this that we come as experts and say, this is how it's meant to be done. Regardless of the money, this is how it's meant to be done for our next generation to be able to come and achieve the dream. The infrastructure has to be there.
Okay, all right. We've been talking to two gentlemen in the studio. We have Sam Sodje in our studio here in Lagos, and we have the first vice president of the Nigerian Football Federation, SEYI AKINWUNMI, is in the studio with us, and we're talking about sports generally in Nigeria. But this time, let's talk about football. I mean, going to talk about football, it becomes, since yesterday, I have not been myself, because yesterday was a lose-lose situation for me, all forms. Nigerian women, you know, representative, yeah, dropped out of the major competition they're in. The under-23 team dropped out, and then Man U eventually lost, you know, I mean, unimaginably to PSV. But notwithstanding, let's talk about football in Nigeria. I've been a fan, and I've been there. I played active football back in the days of principal corps when I was in college, but I just never really, because my parents never really wanted a footballer in the family. They believe that, I mean, footballers are actually public nuisance. Yeah. People who disobey their parents are the people who were playing football back in the day. Now, if you're a good child, you just don't want to go out of your way to start playing football. Yeah. So some of us didn't have that advantage of being able to go professional about it. But a lot of people succeeded, you know, in actually doing football as a lifestyle, you know, for some of us. Now, let's talk football in Nigeria. Now, this sport has evolved, as far as I'm concerned. But now, our major concentration now is that I have come to realize that footballers in Nigeria are, how will I put it, they don't in any way measure to the standard of people who have opportunity to play it internationally. I still see our local players in Nigeria feel very inferior to a Mikel Obi when it comes around, to a Sam Sodje when it comes around, because these are international football, but they've been playing the local league for quite a while.
They play very well, but
they don't have the international exposure, you know, as it were. Now, let's begin to, you know, to just take a close look at local football and international, you know, club sides, where, I mean, a lot of people who are playing in our local league here wants to find a way out to sign up, even if it's a third division somewhere. So, and that's to tell you that the environment in which they are playing doesn't seem to be attractive enough. What has been responsible for this? You just find out that virtually all local players wants to get out.
Well, I think that, you know, people forget or, you know, ignore that football in Nigeria is in Nigeria. If you don't, you can't extricate it from the economy of Nigeria, from where we are. And if the naira is so weak compared to the dollar, people want where the naira is strong.
Good exchange.
Yes. So they really want to go to the best place they can. It's not different. It's like when we had the brain deal with doctors. Because it's football, people then see it differently. But it's the same thing. People are just looking for that golden fleece. You know, when you talk about the inferiority complex, that, because I think that's what I talk about, the players, it's not as bad as you think anymore. It used to be quite bad. But I think that there's a lot more exposure now with TV. You get people who are local players or who are superstars. The other day, I was in my office and there's premiership going on. It wasn't the top premiership side, it was Leicester and somebody else. And Warri Wolves and Quarry United were playing. And everybody in my office was watching Quarry United and Warri Wolves. You know, so it's changing gradually. And the other thing that's happened is there's been this CHAN championships for African teams, where they have their own local Nations Cup.
Yes.
But it's made up of players who play locally. And that has, in the past few years, given a lot of exposure to local players.
All right.
Then we have, for example, now in Nigeria, a coach who says, look, I don't know what is local player or international player. You're either good or you're not. If you're good, I invite you. And that's the really way it should be.
All right.
So it will take time, but it's gradually getting there.
Getting better. Okay, at this point, let's quickly go on a short break. When we come back, we still have Sam Sodje in the studio, and SEYI AKINWUNMI will still be here. We'll still discuss football and sports activities in Nigeria generally. We'll be right back.
So, did you like what you just saw? I know you did. Mm-hmm. It's very simple. If you want to see more, just subscribe to our channel right now.